passion. The hobby is the people. Weekly news and interviews. It's your number one source. Sports Card Nation. The hobby is the people. Sports Card Nation.
Welcome to another stocked and loaded episode of the Sports Card Nation podcast, the show that brings you all the important hobby news, discussions, debates, opinions, info, and interviews with key hobby and sports dignitaries. Also, if you're good, you know we are going to give away something. Now, here's the guy that wanted the cards more than the gum. John Newman.
This is Sports Card Nation.
Episode 96. Sports Card Nation, what is up, everybody? Glad to be back. Friday, coming off the show that my father appeared on. Got a lot of feedback on that show, and very much appreciated. I ask for it every episode, and feel free. We want to know what you like, don't like, all that stuff. That's how we get better. But a lot of feedback from my dad's appearance, and all positive, thankfully, and you know, I thought it, you know, I'm biased, obviously, it's my dad, but I just thought it was great to go back to a time where not a lot of us were, frankly, around, and to kind of get some of that, if you will, behind the scenes, on the scenes sort of commentary from those days, which are so much different than current times. And I know my dad was really you know, happy to do it, and I know he was a little nervous at first, and then just kind of relaxed, and, you know, like I said, at the closing of that show, you know, he couldn't thank me enough. He might have to start his own podcast soon, but, you know, all joking aside, this past Saturday, I went to my sister's, or Sunday, I should say. Sundays, I go to my sister's house, not every Sunday, almost every Sunday. Have like a lunch or dinner. My dad's usually over there, and we kind of get together. And they hadn't heard the episode itself, and so we played it and listened to it, and you know, enjoyed it. And like I said on the show, I think year, you know, forever now, that's going to be an episode we can sort of refer back to and look upon fondly. And you know, a lot of people said, you know, I got a few people said they listened to it more than once, which is saying something. You know, usually you listen to a podcast one time and you're sort of good. But a few people told me they listened to it more than once. Other people said that they'd like to see more of that, you know, and that's something to think about. You know, my dad really told a lot of the story, so maybe even having someone else from that generation to kind of share their knowledge and experiences, that's something I could probably look into as well. But you know, my dad asked me if I heard, you know, from anybody, and I told him all those good things. It made him feel good, and you know, it's always good to make other people feel good, whatever way that is. If it's through content, if it's through giving someone something, helping someone out, that's a good thing. So today on the show, a great guest, a very well-known person, Mr. Brandon Steiner from Steiner Marketing. He sold that company, Fanatics, and he started Collectible Exchange. He's also on the Yes Network and in many forms and fashion. He's doing a new show there, and is, you know, doing a lot of great things. It does a lot of work with athletes and sports, and even our hometown university here at Syracuse. He's an alum of the school, and anytime, you know, we have a new dome. Not the whole building's not new, but they redid the dome with better stuff. It's not held up by air conditioning. It's more of its own structure. So they took the old dome down, and he is the distributor. You know, SU fans can buy pieces of the dome. He's going to give you, the listener, a chance to win some or one of those. So During the interview, he is going to tell you how to get a piece of the dome. So listen during the interview. Brandon Steiner is going to tell you what you need to do to potentially get a piece of the carrier dome here, right from where I'm at here in Syracuse, New York. Pretty cool that we're giving away part of the dome on this show. It's a place I've been to and many times. I'm a season ticket holder for football, although that's not no fans this year. But it really means a lot that he did that. And I got to be honest with you, folks, that I had no idea he was doing that. So when you hear that moment in the interview, that's I'm finding out for the first time like you are. And I think that goes to show you what kind of guy he is. Smart guy, businessman, author. He's written 3 books and very well known. And, you know, like he said, started from humble beginnings from Brooklyn, New York. Another Brooklyn guy. I love my Brooklyn guys. And, you know, made some time for us. And I'm very appreciative of that. So with that being said, let's get this thing underway. Time for this week's
incoming
product releases. All right, sports release wise, nothing. You know, today is the 2nd, if you're listening to the day of release of the show. Nothing till the 6th of October when 2020 Leaf Autograph, their full size football helmet edition, gets released. On the 7th, 2020 Onyx Vintage Extended Series Baseball, also on the 7th. 2020 Topps Triple Treads Baseball. For whatever reason, I've always liked Triple Treads. It's been very good to me when I've opened it, so I'll have to look into maybe getting some of that product, even though I don't open as much as I used to. 10-7, also 2020 Panini Absolute Football. I believe that is a pushback date, and so it's been rescheduled for the 7th. A lot of stuff on the 7th, so rather than keep saying the 7th, all these continue to be on October 7th. 2020, Topps Heritage Minor League Baseball. 2019-20, Upper Deck Premier Hockey. 2021, Topps NHL Sticker Collection. 2020, Panini WNBA Prism Basketball. On the 9th, Decision 2020, Trading Cards. I believe that is a political set. Also on the 9th, 2020, Panini National Treasures Collegiate Football. Also on the 9th, 2020, Panini Spectra Football. That's a product I really, really enjoy. Also on the 9th, 2020, Panini Prism Racing. Also on the 9th, 2019-20, Topps Museum Collection, UEFA Champions League Soccer. And that will conclude the week of new product releases. Some nice stuff in there as well, and so you'll have some options of what to crack or buy or flip or resell or whatever you do with wax. You got some weapons in the arsenal this week.
Sports Card Nation Podcast is your weekly hobby and sports podcast. Now on tons of platforms, including Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Stitcher, and many more. Listen to in 44 different countries globally, Sports Card Nation is one of the most interactive podcasts around, providing great content, giveaways, and some of the hobby's best interview guests without time constraints. Thousands can't be wrong. We want to thank all the wonderful listeners around the world, our awesome guests on the show, and our tremendous sponsors making us what we are today. Remember, without you, there's no us.
One of One Card Shop offers a tremendous breaking experience, great customer service, and they're constantly pulling fire. Steve and his family take care of you like one of their own and treat you right. Anyone can break, but no one treats you like one of one. Come check them out on Instagram at @1_of_1_card_shop. For all the hot breaks, get a gold mailer headed your way. It's time for What's Cracking. Another week, another Topps online exclusive product. This time it's Topps Chrome Sapphire Baseball. Montgomery 582 members were allowed to purchase two boxes. I'm one of those, but sorry to say, kind of crazy day at my at work, and I didn't get on in time, so I did not get the two boxes. They had the lottery to see if you can purchase more or get some, and so I entered that lottery, we'll say, and didn't get an email. So I didn't get any Topps Chrome Sapphire. I guess it's easy for me to say since I didn't get it, but wasn't really crushed. You know, $2.99 a piece would have been $600. I would have did it. I'm not being sour grapes, but you know, obviously I'm not. You know, if you know my MO, those would have been for resale. It is what it is. I can't complain. I've been very fortunate this year. I got a Ben Baller box, another one coming tomorrow for the Ben Baller Chrome. So I'll have two of those here, and I'll be selling both of those, preferably to one person. So, I can't complain. You know, when you try for those things, it's sometimes hit or miss, and I've probably batting close to 80% on getting those products. And in a few cases, I was able to get more with the raffle. Like the archive snapshots, I was able to get three on the Montgomery Club and then three on the open to the public sale. So, very fortunate, won't complain. Would have been nice, but I was just a little slow on the draw, so it's not mad at Topps or anything like that. That was on me, just dropping the ball, not logging on in time.
Coffee's for closers only.
Well, Topps has shown this year they'll make cards of anything from women's softball to cornhole tournament teams, and now we have political debate cards between Trump and Biden. Topps now has made those cards. If you've seen the debate, if you want to call it that, it was just a bunch of sort of name calling and yelling and talking over each other. It was appointment TV to me. I'm sort of semi into politics, and was definitely curious to see how this was going to play out. People may not have liked it, but did not disappoint. If you like fireworks and semantics and Topps, they've shown to get into the political arena before a little bit with the Fauci first pitch card. Now they're really diving in with the political debate cards. And so it'll be interesting to see the sales numbers of these when they're finalized. I myself will not be purchasing any of those cards, although I probably should with all the rewards points I have from Topps. I need to spend them on something. So maybe I will take a look, but if I get any, it's because I have points, not because I'm spending my money on these particular cards. And, this is the year. I mean, if you're going to produce cards of anything, this is the year, because just people are consuming it up and eating it up. PSA, we talked about maybe a month ago that they wanted to, Alter Fox wanted to shake up the board. And while I don't think the board got shook up to the level Alter Fox wanted to, they did get two new members, Laureen Bardeen and Jennifer Lemure, are new board members of the 10, and so there's been some overturning, and with that, Alter Fox has also settled with PSA for the remaining shares there. And so things seem to be settling down. There's some new people in positions at PSA. As we all know, the big three are still backlogged as far as submission goes. So we'll see if there's any improvements on that end and on any of them. Appears PSA is trying to get some more stability, make some changes, new direction, new vision. And both of the women that they hired come from the technology sector. And so we'll see if that has any factor into future technologies at PSA. Okay, full disclosure, this has been added in a day after I recorded that news about PSA. Some late-breaking PSA news, as you may have heard. Again, another price increase on most levels of service for grading. For the sake of time, I'm not going to go into them all, but just know that almost across the board, there's been some sort of price increase. And so it's going to cost you more to get your cards graded at PSA. I think this stems from them trying to slow the tide down of cards that, you know, some people view as not really gradable or shouldn't be gradable. Real recent modern and that sort of thing. My argument to that is if someone wants to pay for it, they should be able to grade anything they want. Now, I guess the answer by grading companies is to raise those modern day prices to maybe stem the tide. So another price increase from PSA, and I just wanted to make sure to get it in on this program since we did talk about them. Well, if you heard Hobby Quick Hits, our shorter form show, episode 31, pertained to the football card market, something I'm very active in and fairly knowledgeable about. I figured I'd take a little bit of time, even on the big show here, to, you know, kind of talk about football season is in full swing. It looks like early on that the season probably is going to be completed in some form or fashion. We just saw the NHL crown their champion. Congratulations to the Tampa Bay Lightning. We have the Heat and Lakers in the finals with the Lakers up there. And football is entering week four. My Steelers game has been postponed from Sunday, being rumored to be moved to Monday or Tuesday with some COVID illnesses on the Tennessee Titans side. So we'll have to see how this all plays out. But looks fairly likely that the NFL season is going to be completed. And so with that being said, football is something I've done football cards for a while now. I know a lot of people aren't fond of football cards. They feel like it's the most inherent risk. And, you know, frankly, that's true. I mean, you know, the injuries you're going to get in the sport of football can be career-altering, career-ending. And, to invest or spend a lot of money on certain guys is scary for some, knowing that one play can change that whole equation. So on the show, I definitely suggest to love to have you listen to it. But so I'll just give you the cliff notes. You know, I talked about how position, you know, quarterbacks, even rookies that come in are usually very high priced before they even throw a pass. If you're a football fan, you know a running back shelf life is 3 to 5 years. Even if you're very good, running backs have a shorter career span, and then teams replace them with the next guy coming in. It's one of the reasons I don't go crazy over running backs. I made an exception for Saquon Barkley, and that's also another tip I said on that show is, you know, when an elite talent comes along and you can acquire some of those transcendent type talent, you really should try to do it at the best price possible. Saquon's one of those guys to me, although the injury bug is starting to bite him a few times, and a little worried there. But when we talk about what position is the best to purchase, like what's the, let's say, the lowest risk and the more hit factor, if you will, boom or bust, what's the more boom? It's going to be the wide receiver positions for a few reasons. Number one, a solid and very good wide receiver is going to play 10 to 15 years in the NFL. That's a pretty good career and pretty good lifespan on career. Unlike other positions, you typically only have one starting running back unless they employ a fullback, and fullbacks don't get hobby love. So you're going to have one running back on the field, one quarterback on the field. But what position has multiple? That's wide receiver. You got 3, 4, 5 receiver sets. So when you build up an inventory of a hot rookie receiver or young receiver, he's got a chance. If he's not already cracked that lineup, they're a lot closer than another position where only one person can be on the field. So wide receivers traditionally, obviously value-wise don't measure up to quarterbacks, but believe it or not, I see that trend starting to close as people catch on. I think, Jerry Rice, the greatest potentially football player of all time, receiver definitely, up until recently, his rookie could be had for a $10 or $20 bill. That's changed now, and then when we get into the grading aspect of that card, high quality copies are going to cost a lot of thousands of dollars. So with those going up, I think some of the other cards that are current are maybe higher than people think. And football is getting the same bounce and buzz that basketball and baseball did with the pandemic going on, and people unable to go to games. And don't forget, while we're talking about football, basketball is going to be wrapping up its season here with the finals, which is only probably going to be a few more games. And then baseball will be wrapping up, believe it or not, or on the backside of their season. And pretty soon, and hockey's now done with the Lightning winning the Stanley Cup, pretty soon football is going to be the only sport of the four major going on. And they're going to have the center stage and the focus of many sports fans by themselves. And I think those cards are going to see an uptick as we've seen all year here in 2020. And I think receivers are probably the best and safest buy. Another tip I said on hobby quick hits is, a lot of times when a guy goes down with injury, take for example, Saquon, a lot of people, it's a second major injury. A lot of people are starting to get cold feet, scared that he's not going to live up to the billing and the hype. I don't feel that way. I think his biggest problem is the Giants' offensive line is brutal. And I'm not saying he's getting hurt because of them, but they're definitely not helping his cause. The guys are in the backfield getting to him just as the ball's getting there in the bread box. And so I think a change of scenery would do him good. But I believe he's going to come back from these injuries. So when guys get hurt like that, if you still believe in them that they're going to be a viable superstar, viable, productive, potential Hall of Fame player, it's a great time to buy as others kind of get off that trailer, that wagon. And so, you kind of switch places with them or add to your arsenal. It's something I've done for many years over. And the other side of the coin, obviously, is if it's an injury to a player where you don't think they're going to recover or it's going to change their game and how they play it, then maybe that's the time to sell, or definitely a time to really kind of hit pause on the buying. So, there's timing, as we all know, in this hobby. Football really reiterates that. And the other thing with football, guys can develop in years, 3 and 4, where in other sports, if it hasn't happened by then, it's generally not going to happen. But in football, guys can you know, not gain a starting spot as a draftee, and then watch a lot of football, and then slowly matriculate themselves into the lineup and then becoming players. And you see that a lot. And so patience is also a tip that I would preach when it comes to the football card market. Don't be too quick to jump ship, and don't be too quick to, you know, go overboard and just spend a lot of money on one guy. So, you know, give it a plug. If you haven't heard episode 31 of Hobby Quick Hits, we talk about the football card market and some strategies to employ. I gave you the Cliff Notes version here. I go more into detail on that show, so check it out.
You want answers?
Hey folks, tired of going to the retail store and finding the wax shelves cleaned out bare? I've got the answer for you, and that answer is Hotbox Cards. They offer a monthly subscription service at a great price level. What's better than getting a box of sports cards on your doorstep every month? Not a whole lot, and these boxes don't cost a whole lot. Let me tell you what's in each and every Hotbox. 3 relic or auto cards, 3 unopened hobby packs, 50 bonus cards featuring stars, rookies, semi-stars, inserts, and parallels. And one in every 5 boxes has a red-hot envelope with a surprise card. They also honor expired redemptions with a comparable item. So there's no worry about getting that old redemption card with nothing to show for it. Check them out at www.hotboxcards.net. October is legendary month. Baseball boxes will have a Laughlin World Series card, and football boxes will contain a legendary star. And put in promo code SCNATION, SCNATION all in caps, and your box will contain an extra hit. Excited to have my next guest on the 101 Sports Card Nation guest line. Like myself, he hails from Brooklyn, New York. And he also, I'm in Syracuse now, and he is a Syracuse University alum. He's a media mogul, businessman, author, you name it, he's probably done it. And I'm thankful that he's given the show some time. Welcome, Mr. Brandon Steiner.
Thanks for having me. I love your backdrop. I know you're a huge collector, obviously. So I love having these conversations. You know, collecting is what I've learned over the last 12 months. And I, you know, listen, my past company, you know, I'm not Steiner anymore. I started Collectible Exchange. What I've learned is just incredible collectors out there that are doing incredible stuff, which we'll talk about, which leads me to my next venture. But I love what's going on out there with entrepreneurism and collectibility. And one other thing we got to talk about is the dome, because you got that Syracuse hat. You know, I bleed orange. So if you're a Syracuse fan, we're definitely going to give away somewhere during the show. We should give away a couple pieces of the dome, which would be cool. I know you probably got some Syracuse fans. And, you know, it just collecting is just, you know, it's in my blood. And I've always enjoyed the collecting and saving part. And I think what I've realized in these times with the virus and everything, that we've all over-collected a little bit.
Yeah.
We all probably collected more than we realized we collected. So it's been fun.
And that's the crazy thing, Brandon, is with the pandemic, like the sports memorabilia market really boomed rather than a slowdown. I'll be honest with you. It surprised me to the extent that happened. I think I've said on this show, I think some of that is more people at home to you know, look at things and purchase things. We had the stimulus package. Those that were unfortunately unemployed got the, you know, a $600 a week bonus. And so initially there was a you know, market-wise, I think there was more money, more downtime. It was sort of like the perfect storm for some, you know, extracurricular spending that people can do. And, you know, when something bad's happening in the world, we generally as humans kind of revert to something that makes us internally happy. And sports, as you already know,
if you're a sports fan, that's something we can all, gravitate towards. And that's the other thing is we didn't have real sports going on. So the next best thing is those memorabilia, those pieces from the sports or athletes. We knew it was going to come back. It was just we weren't sure when. And so I think people gravitate towards the memorabilia and that sort of thing. You know, what your thoughts on kind of what I just said there?
I think that we all went home and realized we had a lot more stuff than we realized we had. And, you know, entrepreneurialism, kind of, you know, this stuff, collectibles are great online. So, you know, like my wife, it's like, what do we do with all that stuff? So I think a lot of people are realizing and they kind of cleaned up their collections. They're being home a lot and maybe they wanted some things because they wanted to redecorate their man caves because they're working out of them.
Yeah.
My new site, Collectible Exchange, you know, I'm not at Steiner anymore, is really a better form of eBay. More verification, authentication, so people can buy and trade safely with each other. And that's exactly what I found this summer is people just wanted to trade. You know, they realized they had too many of one thing, not enough of another thing. And you know how collectors are. We over-collect. You know, we have a lot of AD, a lot of OCD, ADHD issues. We tend to get very hyped up about something. As I look at my 600 Jack rookie cards, probably was a little bit of an overkill in the 90s for me to go collect that many cards. You know what I mean? But so you start selling off some of them, and it also keeps you busy. Because if you remember back in the spring and even the summer, it was just not a lot to do. I mean, still you're kind of limited. So you're home and you're looking at your 600 Shaq cards. You're like, what the hell? Let me put some of these up.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you realize you have a LeBron rookie that you totally forgot about because that was 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And then you start finding stuff. I mean, that's the stories I've been getting. And that's my story. Me, I mean, as much for a collector as I've been and all the stuff I've done with collecting, like I forgot a whole bunch of the stuff that I got, 20 years ago and 30 years ago. And I don't think collecting, though, by the way, is kind of a career choice anyway. It's kind of a life choice. Like, you're kind of a collector or saver, you're not.
Yeah.
There's some people that, like, as soon as they get it, they want to throw it out.
Yeah.
There's some people, no matter what it is, even if they want it or need it, they're saving it. Like Bob Knight, when I went to go do his collection, which was amazing, like, I go to his house in Lubbock, Texas, and, he's like, I'm not a collector. I'm like, Bob, you have 300 pairs of sneakers. You have 80 red sweaters. You have issues, and you should be proud of that. But, it's just funny. Like, he's like, I'm not a collector. I don't collect this stuff. I'm like, Bob, you have over 400 books signed by different presidents and celebrities. I'm like, you're a saver. You save it all. And especially in this, the over 50 crowd, the last of the baby boomers, we grew up in households where our parents were extremely nimble. So we tend to save and oversave. So I'm seeing a lot of those collections with my new company coming in. Matter of fact, every day, I'm seeing people coming to me with 300, 400, 500-piece collections on a regular basis that they don't know what to do with. So we're helping sort that out as well.
Yeah, and like you said, you've moved from Steiner to Collectible Exchange. You mentioned, it's like eBay, but better. Don't get me going on eBay with fees that we could – we'd use up all our time on that. That's not what we're here to do. But you've worked with so many organizations, players, Cowboys, Yankees, our hometown here at Syracuse University. You do a lot of stuff, even speaking engagements there. And you're the host of Memories of the Game on Yes.
It's a new show now. It's called Stadium Authentics.
Okay.
Actually, it debuts this weekend. It airs tonight on Saturday, 9 o'clock, Sunday at 7:30. If you go to Yes, you can look it up. It's on Yes Network. So that's a new show I did. I love Memories of the Game. That was like the hookup where we went and we surprised people and did all kinds of fun stuff in hospitals, police stations, kids that maybe were sick. We're going to continue doing that. I've been just doing that more offline. By the way, on the Syracuse thing, this is a piece of the dome. We took the roof and we cut it up and made all kinds of products. I think over 50 different products.
Yeah.
So if you go to Collectible Exchange, you can get this. And then if you go to my LinkedIn, the first person that messaged me on the LinkedIn will win this piece. This is a plaque with a block S with a piece of the dome. Just go to my LinkedIn, follow me and message me, and I'll send this to you and also make sure you put your address on there.
This is amazing, but there's some really cool products. And by the way, on my website, CX Stuff or Collectible Exchange, I'm giving away any one of my three books for free as well. Any of the listeners, just look on the site and you can buy any one of the three books for free. And I figured during times like this, I mean, you just got to keep people inspired, motivated. The three books are great for salespeople, entrepreneurs. I love the Syracuse Project because it's, well, it's Syracuse. Yeah. And I love it just because it brings me all my entrepreneurship, because they gave me this vinyl worn down roof and I cut it up and I figured out how to print photos on the roof. So, you know, we do UFC collectibles. If you go to the site, we have all the UFC collectibles. And we figured out how now to print famous matches and fights on the vinyl part that's on the floor. Yeah. So we get those and we cut that up, we sell it. So I'm loving that. I'm into like UFC fighting now, the collectibles. That league is it's just amazing, the following and the fanfare. And I'm getting into Indy 500. You know, I don't know if you're a hockey fan, but I just launched MarkMessier.com and AaronBoone.com. So yeah, you'll be buying directly from them.
I'm definitely going to check the Messier out because that's my guy. I'm a huge New York Rangers fan. And so, yeah. You know, I mean, it probably, you know, if it wasn't for Mess, you know, that
1994
Cups, not in Madison Square Garden. And so, yeah, so Messier's my guy. I'm actually, you can't see, but I'm looking over here. I'm actually, there's a Messier 8x10 frame.
Is anything better than a great moment? Is anything better than a great sports moment?
No, and here we're talking about something, you know, Brandon, from 17, 18 years ago, and I remember it like it's yesterday. And, you know, when he kind of guaranteed that they were going to beat the Devils in the next game when their backs were against the wall, and I'm like, you know, as a younger man, I'm like, what are you doing? We, you know, don't, it's already a pressure situation.
Don't poke the bear.
Yeah. And, but he, you know, he talked and talked and he backed it up. And, you know, I'm hoping we get another one soon as a Ranger fan. They're sort of in youth mode and rebuild mode, but they got the number one pick next year. And so, it's exciting.
I asked Mark what he was thinking when he made that guarantee.
Yeah,
and you know what he said? He goes, obviously, I wasn't thinking.
But that, you know, those are those moments, you know. And it's a famous moment. I mean, he could run for mayor of New York and win. And
he's a great guy. He's a quality person, you know, and a great player too. I'm really, you know, working on his website. You know, I've been working with Mark since '94. So I've had a long-standing relationship, and he's just amazing with, you know, working with him. And we're working on a new project that we're going to launch. I'm going to come back on the show in a couple of weeks to launch a new project that he's doing around Game 7s.
Yeah.
I think collectors and hockey fans are going to love this project. You know, Mark is an entrepreneur, though. That's what I love about him. He's into a lot of different things. And I've always been able to have fun on some of them with him and then watch him from afar on some others. So, but you'll get all the intel also on markmessier.com. And him and I are going to be doing a pod, I hope, that will launch in a couple of
count me in there, because two guys I admire and respect on the same show. No need to say more. I'm scatterbrained, apparently, this morning. I got to correct something I think I mentioned 2003, 2004, that the Ranger Cup was 93-94. I think I'm getting my favorite team championship. I'm getting my Syracuse basketball and my New York Rangers mixed up. But, you know, I just want to correct it. Anyone listening be like, you know, 2003, what are you talking about?
I'm going to step aside for a quick break, but when we come back, more with Brandon Steiner. Pastime Marketplace offers a line of durable graded card cases made for collectors who want high-quality graded card storage that is virtually indestructible. Their cases are waterproof, dustproof, airtight, and designed to protect your valuable collection. Check them all out at www.pastimemarketplace.com. Protect your best with the best. And remember, to save 10% off your total order, use the promo code SCN10. That's capital S, capital C, capital N, 10 for 10% off your total order at pastimemarketplace.com. Sports Card Nation is back with Brandon Steiner.
Who's your favorite ball behind you there? What's your favorite ball? I'm curious.
There's about, what do I got in there? About 14 of them. They all have a story. I mean, Mickey Mantle's probably the best one if we're talking value-wise. There's a Deion Sanders one there that I got when he was on rehab with Columbus in the Yankee system. And I was 17. It was 1989. And I followed him to the team hotel. And he was the last one off the bus. And I said, Mr. Sanders, can you sign one? The ball is actually a foul ball from the game. And he's like, follow me. And so I'm walking in the Comfort Inn with him, just me and him. He gets on the elevator. He waves me to come in the elevator. And I'm like, can I do this? Am I going to get in trouble? He's like, and he says to me, I'll sign your ball, but you got to answer one question for me, son. And I'm like, sure, what is it, Mr. Sanders? And he's like, and this was the time period when him and Bo Jackson were like doing a lot of, you know, commercials and who was the best two-sport athlete.
Best sport.
Yeah. And he says, who's better, me or Bo? And I pause, and I want an autograph from 17. And I'm like, oh, that's easy. It's you, prime time. You've got the ball, signed it. Well, here we are now. We're on the third floor. The door opens up, and he's like, all right, man, you gotta go back down. You get me in trouble, but we'll see you. Take it easy. And so I went back down, and so great story. And, you know, and
he's like the only one that I know that can talk about himself in third tense and not even think about it twice.
Yeah.
You know, what do you think about Deion? Like, you are Deion. Like, he's a weird dude. He's weird, man. He's a weird dude.
But yeah, he's in the news again. He's the new coach at Jackson State. So,
and you know, your other favorite ball was, like, Deion's a weird dude, but you know something? Like, he was great.
Yeah.
A guy that was great and was great. Was me. Yeah.
Well, he wasn't shy to tell you how great he was.
I got to do some signings with Mickey, and I got to know Mickey. And
yeah.
People don't realize in the collectible business how important Mickey was, because he had one of the first great autographs. It's a perfect autograph. He took a lot of love and care in his autograph, and he was one of the first inscription guys.
Yeah.
He loved writing a great inscription. Whether it was a curse word or his triple crown or an MVP, he took a lot of pride in that. And it definitely opened up the doors for a whole bunch of different things. I love Mickey. And he was really a fan favorite, but he also cared about when you gave him something that you wanted to look good, you wanted to do right. I just want people that are watching, because I know it's a collectible show, to know that he's definitely one of the core reasons how the business got rolling and got going.
Yeah,
you're definitely one of the, you know, big name, big favorite. Him and Ted and Joe were the big three back in the 80s that I got to do signings with. I was like Ted Williams' last distributor, so I got to meet Ted a few times and do a bunch of signings with him. Never really understood why his autograph didn't measure up to like a Mantle's. But, you know, and then same thing with Willie Mays, another weird autograph, hard to read.
Yeah.
Not that nice, not that friendly, and really never measured up, even though a lot of people would say he's one of the greatest players of all time.
Yeah, he's probably the greatest living one. He's still alive, God bless him, and, you know, he's been called the greatest living ball player that we still have, and hopefully that remains. So, yeah, with Mickey, you know, the one thing, obviously he was done playing when I was a kid growing up in Brooklyn, but his legend, as you know, is bigger than the man himself. But the one thing I found endearing when I learned about him is, you know, he had his problems, but you know he faced them. He was not shy to say, "Hey, I'm not a role model. Don't do what I did. Learn from what I did. I learned from what I did." You know, and if anyone hasn't seen that Costas interview that he did, where he was really brutally honest to
emotional.
I don't care what anyone thought of him, you know, if he weren't a fan of him before that, to watch that and not see someone humble and just kind of say, listen, you know, I made a lot of mistakes, and you know, don't do as I did. And and be appreciative of the fans and what they meant to him and the city itself. And, Hall of Famer, obviously, no doubt. And, I think he's still, even though he's not with us no more, he still can be, he said he's not a role model, but I really think he is. He might be a role model for what kind of he did after his career to help folks. So even if some of the things he did during his playing days, he doesn't want people to do, I think how he the last years of his life, things he said and did make him a role model, whether, he might disagree, but, you got, like you said, you got to work with him. Just a tremendous player, tremendous person. And, it'd be nice if he was still around. But, you mentioned, I'm 47. You mentioned, coming from humble beginnings. Do you appreciate kind of what you've built and what you have because of that fact? I find people say, growing up, we pinched pennies, we didn't have much. And then they've made a life for themselves and they're like, man, I appreciate it more because it wasn't always like this,
I mean, yeah, of course. I mean, I don't necessarily, walk around, and I'm not one of those walk around and, can't believe where I come from, what I did every day, can't believe what but I do appreciate everything. I'm very grateful, but I was grateful even when I was younger. I didn't have much. I was more of a mindset. I was certainly didn't have a whole lot growing up, and I've written about that in my books and everything, but I was never that angry about it. I was more motivated about what I was going to do about it. And I think, listen, you never lose that in you. Like, I still walk around the house, make sure the lights are turned off. I'm still, worrying about the electric bill. I still, look at a price when I go to the damn restaurant. Because my mother was always like, you do not order the most expensive thing. I'll tell you the three things you can order. I still look at the restaurants. Last time I was like ordering a restaurant, I was like, I can't believe I'm still looking at the damn prices on the menu. And I'm contemplating not ordering something because it's a little expensive. Like I need to worry about that. But, I think having a lot of money or making a lot of money is really overrated. I think it's, I think that sometimes people put a lot more credence in the wrong areas of success. And I try not to do that. I try not to put too much focus on the money or the money I may have made, because it really just steers you in the wrong direction. Because we're all the same. We're all, there's a lot of people that, make a nominal amount of money that are extremely, they're doing extremely important stuff. And if I've not really learned that up to this point. I've learned that in the virus, the person stocking the groceries, the person making my pizza, those are all critical roles. Those are all people that you got to respect. So, yeah, I'm grateful for the opportunity to work with all my legendary heroes growing up and be able to make money with them and do business with them. And that's a thrill. I never take it for granted. When I'm with Mariano, which I've been working with him for over 25 years, I tell him this, is that I'm so excited when I hang out with you because I know he's one of the greatest. And his mindset, what I've learned from him, and I'm still excited. Mark Messier is another one of those relationships. I'm still excited. I just did an interview with Lawrence Taylor, who I was with in the 80s before even I started Steiner, before I even got in the business. So I'm still excited. I mean, I realize these guys are human beings. But I think for me, what I've recognized is that, to be great at something, whatever it is, if you're the greatest teacher, lawyer, doctor, if you're the greatest, it takes a certain mindset. It takes a certain discipline. It takes some luck. And it's always something to learn from those people. I mean, I like to think I'm one of the better collectible people in what I've done with the business and hobby. And I like to hope that people that are in the hobby can learn from me. And I'm always up for teaching about, different things that how the hobby has formed and how the hobby can grow. I've always been interested in the hobby, the people that are grinding, telling the stories, creating the products. Half my best ideas have come from the hobby. I've always respected the hobby. I've always shared whatever I'm doing with the hobby.
That's really how Collectible Exchange comes about, because I think the hobby needs a more uniform, collaborative platform that they can not have to worry about how they're going to sell their product, because really their mastery is in creating the product and finding the product. That's what the hobby does. And they tell the story better than anyone. And that's what some of the bigger companies, even at Steiner when it got really big, it was a story that I try to remind myself, but some of the other bigger companies don't really understand that the hobby is extremely necessary. It is the fundamentally core platform to what's going on. It's the best ideas are coming, and they're the ones that are still telling the story. No matter what you put on a computer, they're out there in stores, trade shows, the national, driving this business. So that's how I look at the business these days. It's exciting. You know, I'm grateful to be part of it. I love the collecting. I love the retelling of the stories. And I love keeping those things alive. That's what I'm hoping to do with my new site. And that's what I've been doing. You know, the dome is just a dome. But up at Syracuse, the dome is a big deal.
Yeah.
It's not just the vinyl. It's all the stuff that happened underneath that roof.
Yeah.
The concerts, the perfect season. You know, there's Pearl Washington, there's Coach Boeheim, one of the great coaches. So that's like where my head's at. It's like keeping, you know, helping schools and helping platforms make money so they keep their education, keep their thing going, and then make sure they get fans closer to the game. How do I make the experience better for the fan? And I'm just bringing forward some of the great collectors around the country to showcase and show off their stuff. I always thought I was a great collectible guy who really came up with great ideas, but I mean, it's nowhere near what's out there all over the country. What I'm seeing now coming to me and being shown to me, now that I'm really not focused on what I'm doing, but I'm focused on what everyone else is doing, it's been a blessing, and it's been a great learning lesson for me to go out to the market and go back to my roots of, you know, guys that are in Des Moines, guys that are in Syracuse, you know, all the people that are, you know, grinding out the hobby. So it's been fun.
Yeah, I know you've sort of downplayed your role, but I'll speak for you. I think you're a bigger part of that than you gave yourself credit for there, Mr. Steiner. I mean, you know, I spoke earlier about, you know, 2020 with everything going on in the world, how cards and the collectibles market is having probably, arguably one of its best years in the history of it. You know, I mean, what are your thoughts on it? Are you surprised by it? I am, but you might not be. You know, what are your take on that?
I think it comes from, you know, a lot of smart people that have been saving and collecting. You have younger people that are into it. You have older people that are sitting with a ton of stuff. So it's a little bit of the changing of the guard there. There's some stuff getting passed down. But I'm excited about it. I mean, it's definitely bigger than what I thought. You know, I thought there'd be an uptick, but not like this.
Yeah,
I didn't think that my phone would be ringing and business would be taken off. I mean, I was nervous about starting my new business and wondering if people were going to rally behind Collectible Exchange. But I'm very grateful that I made a good impression on a lot of people that they wanted to get back into business with me. And there's a lot of baby boomers sitting with a lot of stuff that needs to get transferred down and get passed around. A lot of baby boomers just don't know what to do. So I think the collectible business will continue to grow the next 2 or 3 years, if you want my honest opinion.
Yeah.
And I'm looking forward to being a part of it, man. I'm having fun again. I feel like I'm 19 again.
Yeah.
You know, I'm free. I built that, you know, it's nice to have a big company and everything, but it's a grind, you know, and you get into a lot of things, and not to get into it now, but it's just the freedom. You know, I'm with a nice group of really talented people in my new company that we're all in it to win it, which is for the fans and for our customers, as opposed to just trying to figure out, you know, how to go make a number. So I'm blessed. I'm excited about my Syracuse project because it keeps going, and I'm going to be doing something really, really cool with the dome. We're going to create these baseball cards made out of the dome, and we're going to do a limited edition of that. I love what we're doing with UFC. I'm excited about that. And you'll see more websites launched on Collectible Exchange with more players. So I appreciate you having me on. We got to do this more regularly because I love communicating with collectors. I love getting feedback. And you know, if you're out there and you got ideas, things that you think that we're missing or things that you think we should be doing, I love hearing from you. I mean, I get emails and I get you know, messages on my Facebook. I love it.
Well, consider this an open invitation. Anytime you got something new you want to talk about, plug, or just conversate in general, The door is open for you, Mrs. Steiner. And I know you got to run, but I always give our guests, give out those websites where they can see what you're doing. Get some of this great merchandise and memorabilia that we talked about on the show.
Thank you. I'm the Collectible Exchange, cxstuff.com. If you're a WNBA fan, we're doing a big auction for WNBA. Follow me on LinkedIn or Facebook. Love to hear from you. Give me your comments. Come at me. I want to hear what you're doing. Tell me what you're up to. Have a great day. Stay safe and stay in touch.
You too, Mrs. Steiner. Thank you. Continued success.
Thank you. Take care, my friend. Be well.
All right. You too.
I know the chunky that left these chunkies. Newman! Open the door, Newman. I know you're in there.
Hello, Jerry. All right, it's time for Newman's Rambling, where I select one question I get each week and answer it on the air.
John, you seem like an astute man.
Thank you, Mr. Walken.
Maybe you can help explain something to me.
Well, I'll give it my best shot. All right, this week's question comes by way of Twitter from Dak Mac fan David Keppel. And he asked me about a specific 2021 basketball release. But he basically asked, and I'll kind of broaden the question, but he asked, you know, with next year's rookie class not expected to be as strong as this year's, is it worth pre-ordering product either to open or more likely to flip? Maybe it's, you know, just kind of a down year and compared to this one, you know, whether or not to do it. And, you know, as I've said on the show many times, first off, you know, just because someone says to do something, you know, doesn't mean you have to do it. That's on you. But it's a question. I'll give my opinion. That's all it is. I'm not telling you yes, no, or maybe. You know, I sort of like the next year's class. You know, it's hard to compare. You never know what these classes might turn out to be. You got Wiseman, who I really like, who's rumored to be the number one pick. The French kid, Killian Hayes, who's supposed to be good. Anthony Edwards out of Georgia is supposed to be good. Patrick Williams from Florida State, I like. The other guy that's rumored at number one, I didn't say him right away because his last name makes me nervous. LaMelo Ball, who's tearing it up but in Australia, but you get that whole package deal. Dad comes with him and that whole thing. And I think we saw Lonzo Ball regress after that Lakers trade. And so that last name, I'm not trying to, you know, say LaMelo Ball's not going to make it or be terrible, but you know, whoever drafts him, whether it's number one overall, you're getting that whole package, and that would make me nervous. I mean, I like Wiseman out of Memphis, 7-1 center, didn't hardly play there, so he's not a lot of wear and tear. Probably projects as a little bit of an early project, but he's got a good skill set. And you know, there's guys that come out of nowhere or that aren't picked in the lottery that wind up being very good players. I a lot of times, a lot of lottery guys don't succeed. Probably more don't than do. And so, you know, you look at someone like Darius Bazley, who I really like, and, you know, guys like that aren't always in the lottery. But going back to the question about, you know, pre-ordering next year's basketball product, you know, it's always a chance that you might lose. But the way we've seen wax going lately, you almost can't lose. But again, that's in a distance. And so things may change. The climate may change. Where we are in the pandemic or not in the pandemic may change. But, you know, just looking at it strictly from a rookie class, is it Ja Morant and Zion Williamson? No, let's be real. But, you know, those are just two guys in a really good class. There's a lot of other guys in this class, as we all know, that are very good too. And so it may not, you know, on the surface, it's probably not. Next year's class is not this year's class, at least on paper. But if you get, you know, it's, I guess that, then that the other part to that question is, what kind of deal are you getting on that wax? And so, you know, there's always a right a price to buy in at. And so if that price is right, regardless of rookie class, you can, you know, you can always sell it, open it, if that's what you want to do. You know, do what you think. I think gut instinct, usually I've learned gut instinct is that first gut instinct you get is usually the right one, or at least the one you should really look at very closely and hard to what you want to do. But I think basketball is, obviously we all know this, it's an international sport, and while the class and may not be the same as this year's, the product itself will still be in pretty high demand. So I don't think, as long as you buy it right, I don't think you're going to lose. And that, and so that's the key. You get a decent deal pre-ordering, I say go for it. But again, that's your call. Let me tell you about Iron Sports Cards and Collectibles. They're your number one source for all your PSA and now SGC submissions. They offer various service levels at the lowest prices around. They even provide the card savers your cards need to be submitted at no extra charge. Their elite status helps improve turnaround times, and their chat rooms keep you abreast of your subs and the status of your cards. What are you waiting for? Contact Rob on Facebook on Iron Sports Card Group. That's Iron Sports Card Group on Facebook. Or get a hold of Rob on Twitter at Iron Sports Cards. All one word, at Iron Sports Cards. They'll take care of you.
We love our listeners. Without you, there is no us. We care about your opinions and feedback and invite you to reach out to us on any of our social media accounts. On Instagram, at Sports Card Nation Podcast. Twitter, at Sports Card NATI1. Or email the show at sportscardnationpc@gmail.com. We don't ask for much, but if you really like the show, give us a shout out. Tell your friends or give us a follow on our social medias. If you enjoy the show, please give us a positive review on iTunes or any of the platforms you are listening on. Thank you.
All right, that's going to bring another edition of the Sports Card Nation podcast to a close, as always, and meaningfully. Thank you. Thank you, the listener out there, wherever you're listening to us, whatever you're doing while you're listening to us, it's tremendous, means a lot to us. It allows us to put this program on. It allows us to get the guests we have, which is guys like Mr. Brandon Steiner. You know, I said on, I believe, an HQH, you know, sometimes guests will request download history before they decide to come on a show, and it's thanks to you that we've, you know, without mentioning names, a few guests that we've had, they need to know that, and you make it happen. So it's I can't say thank you enough. Thank you, Mr. Brandon Steiner, for coming on and sharing some of his insight of what's going on in the current sports memorabilia times, and talking a little bit about what he does and his company, Collectible Exchange. He's going to give you, don't forget, if you haven't done it already, a chance to get part of the Carrier Dome, the old Carrier Dome roof, dome actually, and I don't know how many, truthfully, I don't know how many he's planning to give away, but definitely go do what he says to win those. I had no idea, that was not discussed beforehand. So had no idea he was going to do that. Very nice of him to do so. And go get yourself a piece of the Carry Dome. A lot of history happened under that dome that you may win. So, again, be safe, stay well during current times. I think we're moving in the right direction. things will slowly come back and, you know, take care. And we'll see you in just a week.